So let's
Sure.
talk about Flat Earth, man.
Yeah, sure. Flat Earth, it is.
Earth. So please, Kevin, I want you to give us a little bit of your background. Tell us a little bit about you. You know, I know you. We met, but I want you to tell the listeners something about you. You know, your background. Like, if you're comfortable talking about like your schooling, you know, like university, all that stuff, your area of study. Please go ahead.
Okay, sure. Thank you very much for the time, Eddie, for interviewing me on this topic. I know this topic to many would be quite interesting or even surprising. Well, about myself, I was born in Taiwan. I'm a Taiwanese, and my family actually immigrated to Canada when I was very little, around 13, I think. So I spent most of my childhood in Canada, and I had most of my education there too. I have a background in biological science, and I have also done some research in the cancer research field. So after that, basically, I spent most of my career time. My career background has always been with biotechnology, biomedical companies, and also some scientific instrument technology companies. And right now, what I'm doing is I have a new startup company with some partners. We're designing, developing, and manufacturing optical products, which include LED lighting, optical lenses, some inspection machines. And basically, in simple terms, we play around with light and optics using their physical properties like transmission, absorption, reflection, and to delineate certain physical, chemical, and optical properties of some objects or substances that we are interested in. And on a wider scale, most of what our products can do, for example, that we have a lot of applications in the so-called machine vision, and also the so-called industrial manufacturing automation. So that's basically what we do, and what I spend a lot of my time on for my work.
Okay.
And yes, okay. So how I got
Yeah.
into Flat
I
Earth,
man, I mean, you have an amazing background. I want to know now, man, how were you able to get to, you know, realize the earth is flat coming from the background that you have?
Well, it was actually quite simple. Back in, I think, end of 2017, around October or something, I was just like, browsing online. I really like what looking up a lot of interesting topics, like not the mainstream ones. For example, natural unexplained natural phenomena, aliens, and extraterrestrial, that kind of stuff, scientific, even some science fiction stuff.
Okay.
So one day when I was doing that, I kind of went into this Flat Earth channel. I couldn't remember exactly what he was talking about, but I think it was talking about something like the Earth not moving, or using some examples like the cannonball. If you shoot up a cannonball like into the air, and maybe after a few seconds when you drop back down, then you actually return back into the cannon itself. So it gave some example that was exactly happened, that it actually took place, this experiment. So it was maybe some sort of a flat earther with bowl earther. They had some sort of a debate or competition, and they conducted this experiment trying to explain if the Earth was moving or not. So from there on, I thought, I kind of remember when I was very little, when I was in my elementary years, I sort of had this kind of story told to me, but then I wasn't thinking, a lot, because as you know, most students basically took everything, whatever was given to them, whatever they're being told, they took them as being the truth, being as real, or they have no reservation about it. They would not question it. So, but now I when I saw that video, then I did some basic physics and mathematical calculation. I thought, that's interesting. How could that be? And then they said it could drop back down to where it actually came from, was because the cannonball was actually moving right along because it has the inertia. It actually moves along with the Earth, just like our atmosphere that we're being told that the whole atmosphere from the troposphere all the way back up to all the way up to the exosphere, mesosphere, right. Exosphere. The whole atmosphere is actually moving in unison with the Earth. So that was the mainstream take on this. So I thought, okay, that's interesting. To me, both models could actually have worked. For example, the Earth in a motion or the Earth being stationary. Two models could actually work, but in reality, what do we actually observe? So from there on, I kept on digging into more and more flat Earth videos, trying to, like many other people, like many flat Earths did, I tried to debunk those so-called flat Earth videos using sound, reasonable scientific methods. The more I tried to debunk it, or the more I tried to,
find answers.
So the more I actually found myself into some sort of dilemma, I could actually back up the flat Earth model with more natural observable evidence than the Bohr model. So that's how I got it where I am today. I'm not like 100% sure exactly what the Earth really look like now, but I'm more sure that it would not be possible to be around Bohr Earth, because from what I have done, I've done a lot of research myself. I spent a lot of time studying, actually going out into the field to do some field work. I also have the famous P900. I always carry it with me. I went out there and then I look at the horizon, trying to find the curvature and all that stuff, and did the calculation myself. So I have to spend a lot of time. So let you know, because I think I'm a very calm, and relatively conservative person in terms of this, the so-called experiment stuff. I normally I don't take everything for granted. I don't take anything that's being told to me as being real or 100% real, false proof. No, so that's me. And so everything right now, everything I've ever learned, I have ever been told about our space, our cosmology, the sun, the moon, the stars. Actually, I'm rediscovering or relearned a lot of things. And right now, my conclusion is that I think we've been lied to all along about a lot of things. And how did I not know about it? Over in all these years, so I think that's because we as the ones being educated, that we are not allowed to challenge the so-called established paradigm. There are a lot of consequences in doing that, as you know, like some people lost their job because they openly talk about it, stuff like that. So that's how I got to where I am today about flat Earth.
Wow. It's interesting because you have a background in the biology fields, not specifically like a biology like teaching, but I have here in Japan, about 2 or 3 years ago, I met an American teacher here. She was a biology teacher and we had an argument. Actually, she was really aggressive towards me, I tried to be very friendly to her, but she was really aggressive towards me on my instance of the flat Earth. And but you're right, because back in college, I remember the very first day of my biology class, the professor told the class, you are not allowed to ask any question besides what's in the book. And
right.
the book basically taught the evolution side, you know, like Big Bang, all that stuff, scientific. And he told us, you know, the very first day when he introduced himself, and he said, we will only discuss topics within the book. We're not going to be talking. I will not allow question that any question that would go against what the book is teaching us. So you're right.
Yeah.
We are not allowed to ask questions.
Yeah.
At a very early age, actually, we don't know what questions to ask. When
we are we don't even know what to ask.
Yeah.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly. Yeah.
As you told me when you were a kid in Canada, well, yeah we don't know what questions to ask. We just see, well, this is weird, you know, like this is, I was reading a book, I think it's this book called Wonder. If you know this book called Wonder, it's a book for seventh graders, I believe. And it's interesting because she mentions when she was a kid, she mentions like she thought the earth was flat because that's how natural it looks to her, you know? And, you know, for us kids, this is how it looks like until the adults start telling us that's the other way around, you know?
Very interesting.
Now, Kevin, one more thing, you know, that it's really, you know, I've been learning more about the East or Eastern cosmology.
Okay.
You know,
you
saw some of videos. I've been digging into the Chinese, the Japanese, and I've been talking to some Buddhists right now.
Yes.
Coming from a Chinese background, how do you, because I think like they have the lunar year, which we don't have in the U.S. still, you know, you have a lot of things there, like the Koreans, even the Japanese, they go by the lunar year in some.
Yes, yes.
How does that play with your flat earth belief?
In that sense, actually, as you know, most Asian countries, or East Asian countries like Japan, Taiwan, Korea, China, even maybe Singapore or Malaysia, a lot of the so-called Chinese, or they have this Chinese cultural background, most of the families there, they would still keep the so-called lunar calendar, which has 28-day month and then 12-month year. So in that case, instead of like 12-month year, if you know what I mean. Yeah, so, and each month they have 28 days. Yeah, as you know, 28 days exactly is the cycle of the moon.
Right.
Like the waxing and waning moon. The complete cycle takes about 28 days.
Right.
So in that sense, I would say the Oriental Asian calendar is actually following the moon cycle more accurately. And people do things, for example, if they, or you know, in the early days, they go out and do farming, or they do, they go out and do some house chores, like getting married, or they buy a house, or they set up a business or company. They're actually looking at the lunar calendar, and each calendar day would tell them what to do or what not to do, what best to do and what not to do at all. They will kind of give you some sort of suggestion. And those suggestions are actually based on thousands of years of experience, accumulated experience. So in that sense, I would say maybe our ancestors, they knew much better about the flat earth reality than the current, the so-called modern civilized developed people.
Right.
Are about the flat earth reality. So as you know, like the flat earth, well, this kind of discussion debate hasn't been stopped at any time, you know, throughout our whole history.
Right.
It's just that it's being suppressed. It's
being
hidden.
Right.
And, but if you dig deep enough, you will find that actually throughout the history, like this debate has always been ongoing. But because of some, behind the scene, this powerful and dark players behind the scene. Some people call them Freemasons or Illuminati or whatever. Right. Those people who are actually in control of the world, they decide how the game should be played, and they set up the rules for playing the game. So if you want to be in the game, you better follow, you know, those kind of rules. So, and I think that's how our precious, despite, regardless what background or what culture you're coming from, I mean, all those knowledge, I think they have a common source, original source, which told us that how the world works, how our cosmology should be look like. And but those knowledge has been purposely intentionally hidden and disinformed or, you know, misinformed. That's my take on this.
Yes. Wow. Yeah. I agree, man. I like that. Wow. It's amazing. I've been, you know, reading more, getting more interest because I lived in Japan before. I'm back here. I've been living here since 2013. Mm-hmm. And it's a side of Japan that, you know, now that I'm into Flat Earth, I'm digging, you know, this side. And I went to that temple where I talked to the man there. He carved the Flat Earth map out of a piece of wood. And that's a Buddhist temple. And it's over 1,400 years, you know?
Wow. Okay. Amazing.
And I told him, you know, like, you know, this stuff was taught by the Buddhists, you know, for thousands of years. And he was surprised, you know, he was surprised about the Flat Earth because he also, as a Japanese citizen, he went to school just like the other kids and he learned the Copernican system. And this is how he got into the education system. And once he got into the education system, they took over, you know.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
How about your friends and relatives, Kevin? What do they say about the Flat Earth?
Most of them thought I was crazy or I'm out of my mind. But at the same time, they're willing to listen to what I'm trying to say, what I have to say about this topic. At least they're willing to give you a take, give some reasonable time to listen to what I'm saying or I'm trying to tell them about. It's all because why am I doing this, like making this such a difficulty for myself? It's not I have too much time to spend or I have nothing better to do. It's because I care about those people who are around me. I really love them. And I see a lot of people are actually suffering in life. It doesn't matter whether they're doing well in their life or not, even though if they're well off or they're rich or if they're not better off. Most people are suffering. Maybe they're, they have enough resources on the material side, the physical world side, they have almost everything or they have nothing. But I see a lot of emptiness in their heart or in their soul because they don't know what's to look for in their life. What's the real purpose for life? What's the meaning of this whole thing? Like, that's why we see a lot of problems in the society where people, you know, they will take their lives and they are always being not so positive, always in a negative mood, or they don't have any hope, or they don't look forward to what's ahead, because they say, okay, life is just like this. It's just, you know, that's it. There's nothing new. There's nothing much more to do than, you know, just, you know, waking up every morning, going to work, and then, you know, 9-5 hour day routine. And okay, at a certain age, you have to do certain things. You go out, you do school, and then once you're done, then you go get a job and do something, and I'll make money, and then okay, you get married and you have kids. Then what's the whole purpose of this whole thing? So a lot of people are wondering, and sometimes they're just too busy to think about those questions. And Flat Earth, how could Flat Earth help them? That's some question that I, I've been asking myself because I because by knowing Flat Earth Truth, it actually helped me personally. So I would like to share what I have been through and how it changed me on this mind and psychological side. And to go further, it actually made me come back to study Bible. As you know, like I'm not much of a church goer, or I wasn't Christian enough to call myself a Christian, even okay. though I had been going to church since I was 13, because some family friend invited me to go there. But okay. I wasn't going there for, you know, prayers or talking to God, or, you know, but it was just for, you know, friend and family thing, and that I went there. But now I have different, completely different view on the Bible itself and as to the existence of God and how God created this whole world, and what's his purpose for the all humankind, and why we're here. And to me, of course, some people just go for the spiritual way. Okay, if you believe it, you have faith and in God, then he's there. Bible is true. But to me, since I'm like more reasonable and scientific guy, so I always try to find evidence to back up what's being told. For example, even what the verses in the Bible. So, okay. and my family and friends, actually, some of them are actually long-time Christians, and actually a lot of them. And I would try to bring up this topic to them. And even I would mention some verses in the Bible, and which somehow translate into something like the earth not being flat, not being round. It could be flat, it's stationary, it cannot be moved, or something like that. And that's something that actually a lot of them never look into. And then I will follow up this question with other questions like, so how do you reconcile between Big Bang and creation? And how do you reconcile evolutionary theory with God's work in Genesis, right? So they could not answer at all, actually. Even though they have a strong faith in God, they are faithful Christians, they would never look into it. And even though when they're being faced with these kind of questions, they are not able to answer them. So that's something I was trying to provide some additional information in their thinking. And fortunately, most of my family and friends, they're really willing to give it a thought, but because of fear of being ridiculed or being it's because, you know, everybody is in the system. They're so right. used to the yes. system. Yeah. They're so used to following the authority. They're so being used to not question right. anything. That's being so-called established paradigm.
Right.
So because of that, even though they trust me as a person, they see me as someone that can be looked up to, you know, because of all the examples I've been set up in life, like they see me as a trustworthy and reliable person. But when I talk about flat earth, a lot of them will just turn away or just being silent about it. So that's something I'm still working on. But at least I see some positive results where people are actually start to think about it. At least they are willing to think again. Okay. If everything that's ever been told was true or not. Yeah.
Okay. Wow. That's amazing. This is a question I've been asking also yeah. a couple of friends of mine.
Yes.
That how they do reconcile their belief in the globe and in the Bible at the same time. You know?
Right.
This also has made me not to want to go to church lately, because mm-hmm. the most of the church, they don't even want to discuss, to bring this subject. Mm-hmm. You know, the established church, they don't want to, you know? And
right.
I find like it's quite superficial. You go there, you praise God or whatever, but at the
right.
same time, you don't take every word as we should take, you know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
yeah,
mm-hmm.
yeah. All right, interesting. So let's move on to our other topic, Kevin. So you do travel a lot, right? You come to Japan like quite often?
Yes.
Okay. So I don't want to get too much like into your business stuff.
No? It's okay. Yeah.
That's fine. But have you been in touch with other flat earthers besides us here in Japan, like in the US, Canada, or somewhere else?
Well, unfortunately, even though I have a lot of Japanese friends, I have a lot of Japanese contacts. Once in a while, I would send flat earth, you know, links or information or some of the revelations I have over the you know, lately, and trying to share with them, maybe this world is not the world you think it is.
Right.
As you know, Japanese tend to be very conservative, and they're very humble. They will not right away say, "Oh, you are crazy, you're insane," right in your face. No, they're very humble and polite, as you know, Japanese are that like that.
Yes.
Most quite often, very often, they will just kept silent. About this, even though when I brought out the question to them, and most of them would say, okay, but I don't understand, or this is not what I've been told. And then some of them will even say, okay, if it's true, then NASA is then we're gonna have to, you know, negate everything NASA has ever told us about this whole cosmological stuff. Then, so most people tend to follow the authority, what the authority had to say about this subject. So it's quite difficult, but it's not only in Japan, but also, for example, in Taiwan as well. But here, people tend to be more talkative. So I would try to engage a lot of people here as well. Mm. I joined a lot of discussion groups about astronomy, astrology, cosmology, you know, astrophysics or astrophotography, you know, a lot of social groups, sometimes online, for example, Facebook.
Right.
I'll tend to engage, I'll bring up purposely about this flat earth topic. In the beginning, people are so angry about what I'm saying. Yeah, very angry. And actually a lot of attacks on some using some very personal words to degrade you or to discredit you or anything you could think of. But since I've been doing this for almost 2 years now, I think some of them start to think for themselves. That's a good sign, because I start to get a lot of like buttons from my postings. So I think that's a progress, some progress here. And more I noticed that some Facebooks have already started to dedicate some groups to the flat earth discussion, even some biblical flat earth Christians, like the from the Hong Kong or the Chinese side. So I think that there's some progress here. Because I will bring out some very concrete and solid evidence, and people can take them, not just blindly, but they can take them and then do some testing themselves, do the research themselves. That's what I tell them usually. You of course, you don't have to believe what I say, but why don't you just go out and do the testing yourself? And if you can convince me or otherwise, then you should still rethink about this flat earth thing, like if it's real or not, how credible it is. You have to go out and do your own research. That's something very important. Don't take everything for granted. You really have to go out and spend some time, really think it through and get the evidence. I think that's a key point.
All right, well, now I know you yourself get some wonderful videos of the stars, you know, and has that influence also when you saw the stars, how they really look like, contrary to what we learn in science books? Has that played a role also in your flat earth realization?
Yes, actually, after You know, when I was still in Japan, I spent a lot of time on my weekend days. I would go out to the beach. For example, I'll go to Chiba, Inage, Seaside Park, and, you know, around the Tokyo Bay area. As you know, there's a bridge called Tokyo Aqua Bridge, which connects Kawasaki and Kisarazu, I think that district. So that's the Aqua Bridge. So that bridge is about 25 kilometers away from the beach, from the seaside park. And so if you, according to the mainstream, Earth curvature calculator, I think that the furthest, under some good atmospheric conditions, the furthest we can see, if you are at the sea level, then the furthest you can see is just about 5 kilometers away. And after that, everything curved around, hides behind the so-called curvature of the Earth. But very often, using my P900 camera, I can actually see all the way to that Aqua Bridge, and I could actually see the supporting pillar down to the bottom of it.
Wow.
So nothing was pretty much hidden under very good, atmospheric weather conditions. You could see that far and very clearly the supporting pillar and down to the bottom of it. So to me, that was my first big revelation about flat Earth, because I simply followed some people who already done this before me, and I just followed how they did it, and that's how I got it. I saw it with my own eyes. I recorded. So from there on, I start to look up into the sky. I shoot the sun, the moon, and stars as much and as often as I could. And the stars you mentioned about, yes. Why we always see that the stars, like, they're doing this flickering thing.
Right.
And so it's like they always, like, the intensity is kind of always up and down. And not only that, the colors also change.
Exactly.
So it's, well, the mainstream explanation was that it's due to atmospheric disturbance, because when light travels through the air atmosphere, the medium, and somehow the light gets diffracted and diffracted and refracted. That's how you see all the colors changing and all the light intensity coming up and down. But the thing is, at the same time, you also see other planets in the sky. For example, you might see Saturn, or you might see Venus, or other astral bodies in the sky when it's flickering, it's been happening. So if, and also they are not that far away. I mean, if you look up into the sky, they're in proximity. So if atmospheric disturbance is true, and that's the only reason why the star flickers, then you should also see some flickering on the so-called planets, right? As we were told, like, planets reflect off the sun's light rays. Right. That's why we see planets, right? The same light rays they're going through the atmosphere, they should also be subject to the so-called atmospheric disturbances, diffraction and refraction. Yeah. So that's how I started taking a lot of videos on the stars, trying to figure out what's going on, what's real or not. Let's say it's not due to atmospheric disturbance, then the star itself is constantly changing its energy state. So that's why you have we can see all the colors, like, that's been they are changing all the time, constantly. And it's very clear. And no matter how many times I try to take the videos, different days at different time, the stars are always there, flickering, changing colors. Right? So to me, that's something interesting. That's something I've never looked into or thought about, because so many others, we just accept what's being told to us. What's being written in the textbook is that the stars It's a ball of gas, gaseous body, and it's due to fusion, or and it's, that's how it emits light and stuff like that. Only when it's about to die, like supernova or something, then it explodes, then it emits all sorts of electromagnetic radiation from very high state energy to very low one. So that's when that happens, then you might see the stars actually collapsing, and then they emit all sorts of electromagnetism. And in terms of light, then you see different colors. So, but that's not what's happening, right? Like, if that's true, then all the stars basically in the skies, they are all exploding right now. Right?
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. I'm not claiming that I'm an expert, but I think that's the basic logic, how things should work. If everything we're told is true, then how come what we observe in reality don't seem like what's been written in the textbook? Then something's completely different. So that's something I would like people to think about. And maybe some people have other better explanation. I don't know, but that's my take on this.
All right. Now, there was a Korean girl, young girl, and she made a lot of noise in Brazil because she lives in Korea and Seoul, but she took some time in Brazil. She spent like, I think, a year studying, and she became very fluent in Portuguese, okay? So when she got back to Korea, she made a video in Portuguese to tell the people about her country, about Korea. And she was explaining the history between Japan and Korea. She was trying to give her take to what happened in history, you know, to Brazilian in Portuguese. And she was explaining how friendly or how unfriendly situations can be. But she was saying, like, geographically, Japan and Korea, it's very close from each other.
Right.
And one thing she said, on a clear day, if the conditions, the weather is perfect, you can actually see Japan from Korea. You know?
Oh, okay.
When
okay,
she said that, you know what happened, right? Everybody said, well, where is the curvature of the earth? Right. And in fact, some people actually, you know, did the math comparing to where she was saying the city to the other city. On a perfect day, it's possible to actually see. It's one of the islands of Japan. I forgot the name of the island. But it's possible to see. It should be hidden under hundreds of meters, you know?
Behind the curvature.
Yeah. So I talked to a guy. I want to do this test, maybe going to Japan, to the city where we can actually try to, you know, see Korea on the other side. But it got to be a perfect day, you know? And then got to be available that day, but you never know when that day will be. I'm kind of busy now, but I want to see if we can, you know, maybe on a perfect day, if we are able to go to one of these cities facing Korea and see if we can maybe, you know, who knows, we can see Korea from Japan.
Yeah, exactly. That's the thing. I mean, that's irrefutable, right? If you can see beyond what's possible, according to the Earth curvature calculation, I think that's pretty much a very concrete evidence that the Earth might not be round at all.
How far are you, Kevin, from the mainland China? What's the distance between Taiwan and China?
I think the closest distance is probably less than 100 kilometers away.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's
so
not too far.
I even heard some fishermen or people who actually work in, you know, on this in the sea, or they're they said under pretty good weather conditions, like, you could see so far where you can even see what's the people or even the islands on the other side, you know, like, you know, from the Taiwan coast all the way to the Chinese coastline. So I heard this saying, some people are claiming that they could see actually 100 kilometers away, but yet I still have to collect and see the real evidence of it.
Right. Yeah. You gotta go and see by yourself, right?
Yeah.
All right, Kevin, let me see what else. I think that's all that we have. We've been talking for 41 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah, I've been trying to keep our interviews short.
Okay, sure.
So I'm looking forward, maybe next time you come to Japan, maybe
Okay,
we can
sure.
have dinner again.
Oh, no problem at all. I'm really looking forward to it. Yeah, in Nagoya, right? Yeah,
Yeah,
so
you're done.
yeah, I know,
I'm
I
gonna
know.
be meeting someone this month, towards the end of the month. And you know, it's amazing how Flat Earth like bring people together, you know.
Yes.
It's amazing. Like being closer to some Japanese people now than I'm closer to Brazilians, or I'm closer to some American, then you know, it's amazing because Flat Earth actually bring us together, you know, like you and me. Like I had
Right.
never met anybody from Taiwan in my life. Like
Yeah.
I have, but never talked to someone, you know, like I do with you. We are friends on
Right.
Facebook. We had
Right.
dinner one time together, all because of Flat Earth. You know, this is
Right.
amazing.
Right. Yes, yeah, I think that's a very good idea. We should have this sort of a support group, and also, a medium to share with each other what their latest studies is, or what if they're having any new revelation about this flat earth thing. I think that would be a very good idea. Once in a while, we can get together, talk about it. Yeah.
All right. So, Kevin, thank you so much, man. I do appreciate you taking a, you know, busy time that you have, you know, busy man, businessman. Thanks for taking some time
No problem at all. Thank you,
to talk
Eddie.
about Flat Earth, man. It's really nice.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me on this show. I'm looking
Okay.
forward to another one. Maybe you can see another
Okay.
one.
All
Right,
right.
thank you. Take
Okay.
care.
I'm gonna close the recording, but hang on, okay?
Okay.
Just a second.
Okay.
When you think airplanes are flying over Bow Earth and then...
Scare in the air for passengers on board an American Airlines flight. The pilot warning everyone on board that they would be landing.
You realize that an emergency landing.
But first this morning, a Qantas A380 carrying about 400 passengers had to make an emergency landing at Perth Airport earlier this morning.
Makes more sense on the Gleason's Flat Earth map. It's in this moment that you realize.
A second emergency landing in less than 2 weeks.
That the Earth is not a spinning ball.
Last night here, we reported on that emergency landing here.
Breaking news, here is a live look at the San Francisco airport where a flight from Hawaii was forced to land because of a medical emergency involving a flight attendant.
Bogota to Frankfurt, emergency land in Manchester only makes sense on a flat earth map. Hong Kong to Los Angeles, emergency landing in Alaska only makes sense on the flat earth map. Chicago to Doha, emergency landing in Moscow only makes sense on the flat earth map. Paris to Shanghai, emergency landing in Siberia only makes sense on the flat earth map. Flight routes and emergency landings, the physical properties of water, the compass, gyroscope, radars and lighthouses, the lack of curvature, all point to one simple truth, that the Earth is